So I have no tech. I'm only just talk, but mostly I'm quite bad at talking monologuously, so it will be most a question and answer session, and that's how I take it. A little brief about me. I have been in startups since we used to call them businesses, and at that time we used to start a business and hope we get some money and get a little rich, buy a car, that sort of stuff. So 97 was when I started the journey. I set up what we used to call financing rights and pros trial, which was moneycontrol.com, which got acquired by CNBC. Then a couple of interesting things in the corporate space, who were trying to convert to things. We used to do services. We used to enable these big giants like IDBI, NSC and stuff. And then I last few 10 years till last year, I was the CTO of Just Dial. Saw it scale from a few calls to all over. So, whatever I have done and been has been because of the team. And that's what I'm here to talk about. Today, in anything, you call it a business, you call it a startup, the nomenclature doesn't matter. You are only going to be as good as your team. Just that. Nothing else. You may say, oh, what about sector, what about market share? They're secondary. The team is the one who chooses everything of these aspects, if you think about it. It's a team that chooses whether this is the right sector, it's the wrong sector, it's the right approach, wrong approach. So that's where I go to my team, or the importance of team in my heart. You're nothing without your team. And I'll start off with some questions. Koyushi has been very kind to provide me with some initial things. I have it right here. I'll start with that. And these are the most common questions asked. So this is just a premise. Feel free to cut in anytime you want, ask for questions, and I'm more comfortable that way than giving a talk. I agreed to do this talk on premise that I'll share where I completely went wrong, and so that no one else makes those mistakes. Because right things are easy to remain sense and all, it's the wrong things which make more importance in getting them right. So, first question that is always there, what is an ideal mix for tech and non-tech? There is no ideal mix. It completely depends on what business you are doing and the team that sets up. There is always confused about the culture of the organization, how tech should it be, how non-tech should it be, should there be business analysts? I don't believe in any such words. For me, the premise is simple. The first 10 people in your team who join have to be people who are willing to pay you money. Whether they can afford it or not is different. But they have to be willing to pay you money to be a part of this venture. They have to like the other people they're working with, they have to find the passion and the idea they're working with, and they have to make sure that they are into this for the long term. The serial teams, I will go on from here, I'll do a jig for 2 years, 3 years, not my cup of tea. I don't understand that. I don't respect that. And this is my idea for you. For generally things, the web is there. You can go on to Google and do a search and find better answers than mine. So, tech, non-tech is a function of what the business has to do. Ultimately, if it is a business which is heavy on operations, your operations team has to be strongest. What the mix would come from your need. And again, the team will decide which is going to give them the position of advantage. Your next 10 guys, the first 20 is important, has to be people who have to just love to work with the first 10, believe in the principle, not necessarily the people who are willing to pay you, but they have to believe in the concept enough and trust the other 10 to come and join in, even though they may be doing something better for them. Then you find the culture of these 20 people, and that becomes your organizational culture. You don't start with the culture and try to fit people in. It doesn't work that way. Culture is a moving thing. It works when people around you who are committed to the cause decide whatever be the rules of the game. And those rules form your culture. As an aside, everyone needs to be passionate, everyone needs to be logical, everyone needs to be process driven for you to start. Because it's a teamwork. It's not that you're solving an algebra problem. What that brings us is, to my mind, a marketing guy is no less a software person if I really make it nuts. Because he's going to tell me how to crack the code of getting the market in my hands. Software as a tool is a enabler. What I do hate, and I seem to use the word hate very well in this, I think we have overboard with our importance on tech. It should not exist in your head that there's a tech guy or a non-tech guy. It's just a function that is needed to run the business appropriately. Tech has become over-glorified. Tech is perceived as a be-all. It's not. It's just a tool. Focus on that part. Work with people who believe in that, not who think they are God's gift to mankind, and you will have a solid team. I'm sorry if there are a lot of techies here and I have broken some bubbles here, but this is a fact I believe in, and I am a techie. I love being a techie, but I don't like the arrogance our class has certainly built up in the last 5-6 years. Okay, next question. I just should thank you a lot, this was really a good compilation. I have talked about this next was culture, I think I have done it. Who do you have as a co-founder? What will a VC look at a team before funding? So, I guess I have given the hints. You find a co-founder who believes in equally or more. Firstly, one of the big factors for me to have a co-founder is someone who's not always nice to me. Someone who'll stand up to me and tell me that you're bullshitting, man. Just get your senses there, go home, sleep over it, and then come back and talk sensibly. You need to have that equation of co-founders. It's very important that they agree to what you're going to do in the long run. It's more important that they disagree with every musical fancy you have and look at it practically. And you have to be the emotional, mental, and personal sounding board for each of these guys. You should be able to discuss your problems, your dreams, your aspirations, your kids, everything with this set of people. That's why they're co-founders. And I don't know, I mean, the founder word is more of a stake forming to me. To me, I will talk of founding team. Founding team is a team, in my opinion, which is formed before the product has taken its first baby steps. They're the ones, doesn't matter what level they join, even the peon is a member of founding team, in my opinion, because they make sure with their empathy that, oh, he's working since 1 o'clock, I need to give him coffee at 2 o'clock. Just that difference can make so much productivity. So it's everywhere in all those things, and I'm more worried about the problem. Second question is an answer I am going to give, which is my personal view. You should not select a team based on what the VC is going to like. The VC is going to like the business. The team is a step to it. And I know that if there is something wrong here, it's been led by something wrong there. I'm not saying the criteria of all VCs are good. All I'm saying is it's not right. What is right is the team is needed for the business and not the other way around. So your team should be there. What does VC mostly look in a team? That I can tell you from other perspectives. They look at things good. They look at how many times you cut each other comfortably and add value to a conversation. They look at how you're co-passionately talking about something. That's what other VC friends tell me. And that's what I would do when I do some small bit of angel funding and all. What makes sense is you know when you're looking at a startup that there's no guarantee of any success for this. You just know this is the right field. And the more important thing is it will stay a right field because this set of people are really good. So what you want to look at it is that are all flanks for it. So people look in VC, look at complementary skills. These are the core functions of the business. Is a collective of everyone collected there good enough to handle all these aspects technically forward? So complementariness is there. I mean, oh, they have 7 co-founders. Oh, they have 11 co-founders. Does not matter. You may laugh at the housing because it's not succeeded, but think of the Infosys also. They are equal in number of founders, so it doesn't matter. What matters is the chemistry between the co-founders and the kind of complementary skills they're bringing. Pertaining to that part, don't overskill it. The biggest problem in the skill, what not to do in a team building, is do not take overlapping people with non-overlapping philosophies coming to the same team. You just because you're getting 2 great marketing guys, you get them both together and they don't see eye to eye as a philosophical match. They don't believe in the same things. That's a sure recipe for disaster. Process or no process? First, till you know what you're going to do, the process doesn't work. If process work, everyone will be doing the same thing. There is no formula to make a startup work. Startup has an X factor. I'm not a believer in process in the farm stage. Still, you have hit your 1,000 customers or 10 customers, depending on your scale. Basically, if your addressable market is 100x, till you have hit 1x or 2x, don't even think of processes. You have to go like where no one has gone before, that's why you're successful. Which is going after everything that your intuition, your gorilla, your gut tells you. It's more gut driven. There's a process, I'm not saying there's no process. But it's not a check mark process. The process is following your intuition, trusting your people, and letting everyone come in. Retention, again, growth is the biggest retention problem. There is no other comparative problem. If someone wants to grow, in my experience, and I have made a lot of mistakes trying to retain people by being unfair or trying to say, oh my god, if it goes, what's going to happen? It's never worked out nicely. If someone wants to go, see if there is a wrong or there's a misunderstanding caused this year. In my cases, the retainable ones have only been the ones where there was a sudden flare-up of emotions, it was emotional, they just took it wrong, some of them are suppressing, they suppressed it, then they suddenly burst out, and they immediately realize. When you talk to them and it's sorted out, ask them to retain. If they're asking for X amount of pay and they're retaining and you explain and you have a fair process by you. If you have been unfair, then you have to do all this stuff. But if you're fair and you know that it's fair and you cannot do much about it, it's an unfair ask on his part of literally just let it go. That's my opinion on retention. So if you want to retain, get your fundamentals right. People, I don't know of many people, exceptional cases if the client is too high, living for 25% pay hike. I don't think so. People leave, people work for respect is my first premise. People work for respect. In the absence of any other form of respect, the brand of the company and association of the brand and the salary becomes a benchmark of their mark of respect. If they feel respected and if they feel fairly done, I guess then they will leave. Maybe I have been extremist. My top guys, my first 20% guy, knew everyone's salary, including mine. And that's a case I've always had. I've encouraged that. Because that is what makes secrecy makes things unstable in the company. The company always looks with other than that, never make other than that. That is what your first pillar is of. It's saying everything is open, guys. This is how it is. And then you should be able to explain why it is so. And then I have never seen a retention as a problem. This is one thing I take great pride in. Let me just tell an incredible experience. I was quite successful in tech. I thought people respect me and I get guys wherever I go and all. So with that, I decided to jump. I merged my company into a company called Azure Supply Technology called Geodesic, and I walked on to Just Dial with the CTO. And when I called up, no one wanted to join. I was surprised. Who wants to join us? All said. And no matter what vision and all I talked about, they had no thing. Finally, I called up someone. I had taken my first trip to the region to Singapore. And I said, I said, do you believe in me? I said, yeah, I believe in you. He just took the next ride and came back. So I said, okay, one. Then we went to Pune and we were interviewing and all. And then I saw someone playing a game which I used to play. It was a game called Ragnarok. Ragnarok has very strong guilds. And anyone who plays Ragnarok has a certain level of maths. I was so desperate. I just talked to the guy and watched him play. I played against him. And I said, how many people do you have in your team? He said, 7. I said, all 7 of you are included. And that was my first team. Now, I wanted a gamer. In retrospect, I force-fitted a logic to it. But it was my intuition, my sheer intuition speaking. A gamer is a guy who has a die-hard attitude, who can take defeats sporting and never give up. So it worked out great because they came with that. They were a set team. They were protecting each other and backing each other up. I couldn't have asked for a better team. Funny thing is, they're out on their first jobs. They're still on their first job. They're still in Just Dial. It's been 9 years. So, are there any rules for team setting? No. But when you know a team is not working out, you should be able to. They form the corpus. They form the culture. And they form the attraction for the next generations to come. we scaled up to one. One thing we did was very important, and this is what I'll end my talk with and then open up to questions. I was very clear about one thing. Your recruitment should not be an elimination process. It should be a selection process. And I explain to you why most of you follow the process of elimination. You have two places, that's what you think. You have six applications. Your whole focus is on eliminating four guys. Not on selecting the top two. Or not on selecting the fitting two. I can wait endlessly. I will not recruit till I get the right guy. I will take the pressure, I will cut down my project, but I will not let an infestation of wrong culture enter something I'm building to very well. There was a time when we had a pressure. We said, maybe we are wrong, maybe the world has changed, let's recruit. We actually hired, or rather, we didn't have those terms in those days. We just took over a company which had good people and good skilled people where business was not going. We said, why don't you all join here? And we thought it would work. 6 months down the line, we just saw that they are just theoretical. They don't give any excuse and all. And our deadline was coming 3 months down the line. It was a major release. Ad campaigns had been planned. Everything has been booked. So I called my core team because there was a difference. We tried to improve, but they just hung on to their own part. I called my team and said, what we do? They said, this is killing us. We are growing as people. We are actually starting out talking to each other. Let's let them go. Mm-hmm. So what will work? So we'll manage. One day, of our team of 30, I let go of 16 people. It's proper surveillances. And this working work day in, day out, we only got delayed by the week. That's it. I'm open to questions. Yes, please. I've been asked to stay within this Lakshman Rekha.
Yeah, yeah.
Otherwise, I would love to jump there.
Hi, I'm Ashish.
Yeah.
I have a question with respect to your comparison with VCs and co-founders.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think the VCs, going after funding is also over-glorified to some extent?
I never said that. I said there is wrong on that side also.
Okay.
I do think I am not completely... See, I understand why they are doing it, but doesn't mean I appreciate it. Okay? They are doing it because they think this guy has gone through an IIT entrance, an IIM entrance. Kuch toh hoga. I'm safer betting on this guy. But if you look at it, the real business in the Silicon Valley never did. And here we are trying to have a set of people who are going by, because we are just humans. There are so many people, it's a different set of problems. So I appreciate why they are doing it, but that doesn't mean I subscribe to it. I think they are doing it wrong. Personally, I believe that in that concept, that a bunch of engineers can understand business, and just because they have high IQ, is fundamentally wrong. Because maybe I understand 10 of it, or I think so. To me, that's the easier part. The real tough part is cracking the market and cracking the mindset of the consumer. And any guy who has that intuition, to me, is much more valuable than a tech guy.
What do other than money?
Sorry?
What do
other than
money?
Skin in the game, other than money. If I like my first set of people to be people who would challenge me in the concept itself. So if I'm doing a medical thing on pulmonary research, on stuff like that, I would surely want one of the engineers to be a cardiologist. Because he'll tell me if I'm fapping. And I may not be knowing, but I may be fapping. So having a subject matter expertise group of investors makes a lot of sense. That could be VCs also, depending on what their experience is. Just money is useless. Useless. So, but I'm not the right one to say. I have not been able to, or rather, I have never had any reason to raise money. We have not had to raise money. We have bought money. This is a walk-in giving money. But we never had the reason to use it. Honey contractor time ago, the concept was not there. Just that also, we raised money when you are what we call other income part. The business self-funded the growth. That is something I understand, I believe it. So I am one of the old school guys who believe in EBITDA. Maybe it's a wrong way, but that's what I look at. This question, I think, if you ask to some people who are good at raising funding and all, And they have a different take, and they have been very successful. I guess that it's horses for courses. I can't answer some of the questions because I'm an expert. Yes, please. Just because I'm looking here, if there's someone here before, please do mark it up. Yeah.
I'm sorry. The initial days of team formation. So we encounter a lot of the rapport is less and the trust is less.
Yeah.
And we encounter challenges. So how do you face it?
So that's a very good question. So it's part of the process. You have your interviews, but you don't recruit at that point. Interview is just making sure that the checklist is done, people emotionally know. We make sure at least three people interview the same person. And we have our interviews are a very slow process in most of the cases we have. It takes 3 months to get us enough pressure and all that. And sometimes we do it in 5 minutes. So there's no rule, but there is a process to it. The thing that we should do is whoever wants to join, we make them be with us for it before we take them. How he sits, what he talks, how he eats, how he looks at others. Somewhere there is something that tickles a fancy in him or tickles an avoidance. Now, whatever it be, I don't care if it's a logic, it's not going to work. So there's no point trying to force it. There are exceptions, obviously. Sometimes you do get people because you think this guy has something. I'm not going to figure out. He defies all rules. That's a gamble you take. Some gambles you have to take. They may work out, they may fail. You have to have the heart to correct it the moment it's perceived to be wrong and go ahead. Did I answer the question? Or?
In case we encounter some friction with the recruiter or initial team, so what set tips or things you do?
As I said, talking is important. If there is miscommunication, you have to play the role of arbitrator as a leader. But then you have to, if it's unsolvable or unmitigable problem, you have to let them go. And that will depend on whichever side your business is on. That's a hard problem. Now that doesn't mean whichever side of your business has more importance. So don't mix these two up. Who's more important may not be who's more needed. Someone who's not important may also be needed. You have to pick the right call. If that went up, it's not very important.
Intuition versus rational. You interviewed a guy, competent, highly competent. Your intuition says might not work. Have you come across such situations?
Of course, I own intuition only.
Your experience with the first and the second organization?
I have decided to believe in intuition because I made a lot of mistakes with the first approach. So that's the reason I believe in intuition now. Because as I said, it's everything that I do now is not because I am an egostatic person and I am sticking to it. It's because it's given me the dividends that I deserve and the other way has not. So it's a maturity that has come. And again, this person, because how my intuition works with people may not be the same as how his intuition works with people. He has to make his own call as to which path works for him. It's not a prescription, it's just that it is okay to be following what works for you and not anything that anywhere else goes. In fact, the chance that it will work and give you a special impact is minimal when you follow anything that's written down. Because if it's written down, it doesn't have a position of advantage. Everyone knows the same. So if you are looking for a hack, if you are looking for something special, you have to question yourself and find your own way out. But let me also qualify it that my definition of intuition is the definition of Asimov. So intuition is the ability to come to the correct conclusion from incomplete data. So it's not like it's a wish or a hope. It is data driven. But I may not be logical enough to logicize the data, but it does give me a value.
Hi Sandipan, my name is Madhav.
Hi Madhav.
I want to know that when you offered people jobs, those who you knew well, but they didn't join you. So what was the retrospection? So if like we as a startup...
Nothing, it's part of the game. Very few in my case, because we go through this lengthy process. We don't give an offer unless we are sure our guy has somewhat told he's keen to work with us, but it does happen. Personally, I dislike mercenaries, So I make sure there are certain things. That's the reason we, but again, I have done it. We have given offers, people have not joined. They have shown the offer letter, they can have a stamp of approval and just want their height, their salaries inside and all. So I used to feel very bad when I started out. What is this backstabbing and all? But yes, it's a fair market. If he is getting a gain out of it and that's his way of gaining in life, I don't know how far he'll go in life, but I have to accept it. I made a wrong call in that case. Because this guy culturally should not surely have not have to do. He would have just invested into the bank feelings in the organization. So in a way it's a saving case. There are extreme cases where I had a person who had to move because his parents passed away. Then he got some financial capability and financial liability and he had to move and join MNC. And anyone who joins that is a villain in my eyes. Because if you are bright, if you can give country, you should join a startup. That's how I tell the guys. So, within 3 years, he came back into the 50% partner to join them again. So, if you build solid people, they will come back. If they are not solid, you're better off letting them go. So, if someone, as I said, and I stand by that, if someone wants to go, for whatever reason, do not investigate. Try to see if it is for a harm that someone else has done to him, or you have done to him, then go ahead and leave. Be clear on that. As long as your conscience is clear on that, let him go. If he still wants to go.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
You can shout.
Hello, I'm Shah. Like you talked about tracking market and reading customers' mind.
Mm-hmm.
So like how do you do that? Like customers are least interested in giving you feedback unless you have done blunders to them. So how, like you tell them to email the feedback, but nobody is interested in emailing you feedbacks. So how do you actually do that?
Well, it starts way back. You have to realize what you think is your specialty. And what we believe is our specialty always is we are the ones who can translate a want to a need. Because a customer is not initiated or an expert in your field of opinion. The only reason he has a need for your service is he can give a want, but he may not be able to articulate or tell you what he needs because he doesn't know what are the things you can do. So if you go by that methodology and you are not just tomcoming whatever he said and say, oh, I've done it, see this check mark, why are you changing your opinion now? You come across that situation much less. The situation you do come across is, once you do something and you raise the bar, his expectation goes much more. And then he starts getting the confidence that, oh, anything logical is easy to do. Then you have a problem at hand, but it's a good problem to have. You can always tell him that, look, you may think that this changing this icon here and having an impact all across the screen is a big thing, but you know this is what we go through. Just open it up and so this is about a code that we like to do. I do it. Transparency works with everyone, including customers. If you are transparent, if you are solid, if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear. Anyone. And if he says, oh, you are taking more time, could be, please go to someone else. No problem.
Hi, I'm Sandipan.
Yeah. Where are you there?
So, the question is, my name is Prakash, and I'm asking a question. Most of the time when we start forming a team, we tend to get the people who are very talented. In that process, if you are having multiple people who are talented or equally interested in the idea, then at some point in time, you find out that there is always a guy who is more interested and he's always willing to take initiatives, come to you, because you are the founder, let's say. You are the person who is heading the startup. And then what happens is suddenly after 1 or 2 months, you find that that guy is really interested and he's working also, but then other start thinking that the bosses or the person who is founding the startup is not being transparent based on the or what are the strategies. That's where the unconscious biasness and the sense of risky comes within the team. How do we avoid that?
So I'll start with an anecdotal experience from there. We have this term, wherever I go, I've carried this term across, of chiding someone very jokingly. Amul factory. People sometimes go a little bit over to impress. You just shout it out jokingly, it's an Amul factory. And that culture prevails. They don't do anything to muscle out of it. Only passion shows up. As a culture, you enter it by joking about it but trivializing it also. Then you have lesser of those false positives, right? If someone is taking more initiative and everything else thinking equal, this guy is a leader. Make him the leader. let him follow. Now that doesn't mean that the other guy who's skilled need not be his senior. Job function and seniority has nothing to do. The junior most guy can take charge of doing a movie portal in which my most senior technology is working as a resource. In the ambit of that project, he is God. Even the senior most guy has to obey the deadlines given to him. In the ambit of technology, he is God. So, as Indians, we shouldn't have a problem with that. We are used to the concept of multiple gods. Yes, please. Who's next? I will not start with my first employer. Or my first performer. So,
how was it convincing the guy or candidate to join? Like, there is a trust deficit, you know, he's just starting or he's just launching.
Let me rephrase what I have said first. The first 10 guys should be people who we don't need to convince. Who are convinced enough that chance will have to make as a partner. I want to be part of this. Your first 10 guys have to be your partner. I am not a very self-reliant person. I don't have a huge amount of self-confidence. I don't start unless I have at least my core people interested, set of people interested. Not even a project, forget a venture. Even a unit if I want to do, unless I have 5 people agreeing with who I trust, I will not start. That's what we're both.
So you talk about culture. I just wanted to know what it takes to build a great culture. I work in a corporate and I know that in a corporate it takes a lot of years to build a good culture. So in a startup where there are 10 or 15 folks out there, so how they build a great culture out there? Yeah. Your views on it?
I mentioned it a little bit when I talked about what is culture. I don't think you can build a culture. You have to find the believers. Find them together. And whatever their rules are, make that your culture. So a culture, you cannot form a culture, you can see a culture build and you can chip off the bad blocks and smoothen the edges. It's not going to be a perfect piece of art if it's a collaborative piece of art, but you can always edit it to make it better, but again with the consensus. If it's enforced, typical things don't work. You believe someone, you respect. You don't believe someone just because he is in a position of power. You may have to, but you won't like it. And if that is the case, you will never stay.
Guys, a small request. Please raise your hand so that we can give you the mic.
Yeah, my name is Asim.
Hi, Asim.
Yeah, I have an idea and I'm looking for co-founders.
Mm-hmm.
So how do I go about sharing the business idea? So if I,
Okay, good point. Don't share the business idea. Share the sector. Share the problem you are trying to solve. And then meet people and discuss more. It's probably going to increase the net amount. Someone may not understand the communication of your business plan and you may miss out on a guy truly interested in the sector. So over-reliance on the business plan may be actually developing. It's easier to have a broad spectrum and say, this is the problem I'm trying to solve. These are the people I'm trying to solve it for, and this is the financial impact of this market size. And then you do your thing. Because if you have formed a business plan, you are notionally telling the other guy, hey, you know what, I just need you to fill in a place. I don't think I'm leaving much room for you to be great. That may put up a lot.
How
do
I decide what share of
That's a negotiation process. I mean, it's something that all of you have to expect. There is no rule to it. Good thumb rule is, forget the person, forget his negotiating power. Look at the fundamentals underlying. How important is tech for this business? How important is function? Be fair, you will have a team. If you are not fair, just because you can be powerful, you will not have a team.
Hi sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm so as you said, I just took like let off a guy yesterday itself.
Mm-hmm.
Like because of the standing issues and stuff. So we let off yesterday.
Did you do it out of anger?
No, it was.
Good. Okay.
It took 2 weeks to like to solve this. Mm-hmm. Like, it did not happen. But my point is that once he's gone, that place is empty. Okay. And if we try to fill that place, like suppose it's tech. Okay. So I don't know tech. I don't know like how to build a website or software. So that is empty. If I go in and learn starting, so start learning and do that basically take months. So to take, do you think that you should have backups for everybody in the team, like group tech guys or
a good team would always have a force majeure for themselves. If you really love your project, you would want to make yourself redundant. So that's a reflection of how strongly the team was at work. Because one of the first fears you have to put in, and you have to lead by example, there is that कल मैं कोमा में जाऊँगा तो business नहीं चलेगा क्या? तू लोग को तू लोग क्यों? So that part of delegation you have to start from the beginning and percolate that as a culture. You'll never face the issue, but that's like a post-factual thing. It's easy to say in retrospect. I have done the same mistake all the time in the past. Now maybe I do less of it, but I still do it. It's important to know that you are right. No matter what the cost is, you will probably be able to get feeders, you will get the functions done. But if you're running business, you need to be sure that you can trust the guy who's backing you. It's like a war. You can only focus on winning the battle if you know someone is protecting your back. And if you are unsighted, he's going to take care of that problem. If that thing is gone, you are actually anyway going to make a loss. Because, so what I advise to you is that don't think of tech as a problem. Tech is a thing that you know as a process because you are leading the business. I assume that that's where it is there. So if that is there, you should be able to sit with any junior programmer also and get it done. You have to put in more effort. You cannot just delegate and say, who called it? You have to sit with him and say that, what is this block? Can you put a error to send here and say, what is the data coming to here? It's logic. You are a bright guy. It's coding is no big shit. Sorry. Coding is no. It's not something abnormal. It's something that if you apply your mind to, it's not that complicated to either. You know that you can ask him, where is this coming from? What is the data before that? It's quite doable. If you sit with the guy and let him be the emotion operator, that trust is what you have to build and that intention is what you have to build. If you think that you cannot do it, you cannot do it.
Hi, hello sir.
Hi.
My name is Deepu and you told me that the first 5 guys, you don't need to convince them.
First 10.
Yes. Okay.
Depending on the size of your company.
Okay. In that case, usually the people who give convince on your idea is the people who know you.
Not necessarily. Not at all. I mean, my first venture was someone I didn't know at all. We met at a seminar and we just got along. So that's not a prerequisite. The idea is, I didn't tell him I'm going to do exactly these things. I told him there's a problem in personal finance. Everyone thinks of race, Jua, Chattopadhyay. I don't like that. I want to bring respect to you back. He said, I exactly think the same. And we started talking.
And what are your tips to find good founders?
I just told him that you have to just make sure that you don't over-articulate it. Because then the creative degrees of freedom are much less. And someone who really deserves to be a co-founder will miss stuff. Because he'll think, there's not much to do. Who wants to do that? Co-creation is important for co-founders. If you're not giving a co-creation space on the first premise itself, you're causing doubts whether it will be possible in the future or not. So it has a problem. Yes, please.
Yeah, Sandipan, you have spoken about your hiring process. You also have a firing process. How do you compassionately fire?
I just was talking to, I forgot your name. Sorry. Yeah. So I said that if you have a fair remuneration process, people leave when they know they're not fitting. I didn't have to buy much. If the guy knows that no matter how Magash Patti or Amul Factory BD will get me anywhere other than my work, and I'm not as talented as the other people, if he's talented, I need him. Why should I buy him? See, your remuneration process has to be very fair. They have to know you're sharing everything, your pains and your wealth. It cannot be one side. As long as that is fair, so my senior most guy, my top 14 guys, they had 50% of their salaries locked in non-personal involvement. 15% was based on how their juniors, their chain performs. 35% was based on the company sales. It's not my control, the marketing people fucked up. So what? It's a business. If the business is not running, you cannot run it. That unsolvability and the impunity they're giving tech is not healthy. I'm standing here and telling you,
So this is wonderful. Could you just highlight this a little more, like what you've already said, 35%?
So the company is growing at a particular rate.
Yeah.
For that, you get 25% of it, if it meets the rate. The other 10% is based on the amount of imposed growth. So whatever sales guy has a slab wise target, we make sure our top 14 guys have that. This one had a team of 300 or so. So this is why really the top guys, and they should drive business. Tech should not be an isolated bucket sitting somewhere else. It has to be part of business. It has to feel the pangs and the pains of business. And that's what is very important, joining, not keep it inertly as disassociated. That's my company. And maybe that's the reason my team, when I say, in a way, everyone is my team. Any department, anywhere. And most people were encouraged to welcome. I even get the liberty to my marketing guys, if some customer is getting value, just put the phone on and call this guy who's done the module. They knew exactly which page has been done by which guy. Transparency. Complete transparency.
Sir, my name is Roshan.
Hi, Roshan.
We talked quite a bit about the A-team. I want to ask you for your tips. While forming a company, any pros and cons for working as a single co-founder, or is it necessarily having co-founders?
Nothing is necessary. Whatever you're comfortable with, whatever works is better. I can tell you the personal view on the advantages of having co-founder. And they're mostly that redundancy factor, firstly. When you start a startup, you have people dependent on you. If something happens to you, what happens to them? You have to think of that, firstly. Secondly, you're not going to be, you're not a robot. You're going to have your ups and downs. If you're ideally better off not having a face matched person. In many ways, it's like marriage. Just the body language alone. So, I would look at it that way. There's no reason to marry. You can also adopt a kid. But, yeah.
So, on that note, polygamy, should it be just one co-founder or multiple wives?
As I said, as long as all the Bible reports of the business are covered, you can have 100 co-founders, doesn't matter. The highest I know of a very successful venture, there was 17. And it was needed. Great. Sorry? Quickie. The co-collaboration, co-invention space out of New York. Very good guys.
So we take one last question. What's your question?
And he has a question, so who has a question? Okay. I think fast, so maybe take two questions.
Sure.
Okay, alright. So my question was you said about when you're hiring the first few people, they should be convinced. Especially for a startup, when you're trying to hire them, everyone will agree to answer me. The idea is great. How do you weed out the chaff?
You have to be aware of what they are saying and whether they are saying or crapping or not. If you're hiring a tech guy, you don't know tech, get a friend who knows tech. I always say that when I hire a business guy.
No, the point is about him believing in the philosophy or the idea.
I don't think it's that easy that people say that. There are things will come out with little late. My first question that I ask him, he says, always, by the way, this is a good tip. I always ask the guy to say something about himself and keep on speaking till it's over, which is not there to see. And you'll be surprised how people just get stunned. I measure a lot of things, I don't know what all I measure, but somehow that first question gives me a lot more idea about the guy than any other further questions. And I have started relying on that factor. What accidentally happened, I had not got the guy's CV, so I was trying to pull it up from my laptop. So you can engage high end, when you tell me something about you not there in the CV, it came out from me. And then this guy started stuttering and all those things. So I saw this stupid question and stuck to me. That actually is a very good way of doing it. What is the art of interviewing is very important. And my dislike to do that, I ask sometimes irrelevant questions to throw him off. And suddenly then switch back to relevant questions. I want to see, because I'm a startup, I'm going to have this, mad days. I myself am mad. He has to deal with me. So you better see that whether he's psychologically apt for it. If he goes, huh? I was like, okay, I think you know testing. So I'll go ahead.
Hi, Sandipan. Hi. This is Deepak Kansal. I do not deal in forming startups.
Okay.
I come across only startups a month. So whenever they come to me, they say, Deepak ji, we form a company now. later on if the IT doesn't work, can be closed down. So I just want to know why they have their negative mindset in their mind before they come and start a company.
Okay, I'm going to say something which is probably going to get me crucified. And I only give that one line answer. Do not start up for passion. Only start up if you have the passion for it. That's it. Thank you guys. Really love it. Good questions. Keep it coming. I'm here if you want to just hang around and all. Feel free. Thanks a lot.